Okay, welcome to another video. So we've got a nice one to take a look at today. So Zorin have just released a beta for their newest version, version 16, which we're going to go ahead and get installed today. Before we jump straight into it though, we're going to have a quick glance at the release notes and see what's new. So first things first, we're all going to be getting a stunning new look. So Zorin OS 16 has been refreshed with a revamped and refined appearance out of the box. We've introduced a new, more polished default theme that's easier on the eyes. You'll find detailed touches and delightful animations throughout the system that will elevate your computing experience. And to me, Zorin OS has always been one of those quite attractive and pretty looking distributions, so it'll be nice to see how the new theme brings everything together. We've also introduced new artwork and desktop wallpapers out of the box. You're greeted with a dynamic wallpaper that changes based on the time of day. The lock screen now displays a blurred version of your desktop wallpaper, so we'll check all this out once we are fully installed. Faster and smoother performance. Speed has been a top focus of Zorin OS 16, so the desktop runs dramatically snappier on a wide range of hardware, old and new. Performance optimizations have been made at every level of the operating system, from the kernel to the desktop environment. Apps open faster, animations are smoother, and loading times are reduced so you can spend more time being productive. Nice. So we've now got FlatHub included out of the box as well. So you'll notice in the software store in Zorin OS 16 that they have the addition of the FlatHub repository. FlatHub is the de facto standard repo from where to get apps using the Flatpak package format. Now Zorin OS comes preloaded with the app catalogs of FlatHub, the Snap Store, and the Ubuntu and Zorin OS app repositories, as well as the capability to install .deb and app image packages and Windows apps using Wine. Very cool as well. What else have we got? So it's now got a new sort of welcome tour, and we'll go through that once we are fully installed as well. And we've now got another distribution with nice one-to-one sort of motion of touchpad gestures. So I'm probably going to have to also install this on the laptop, and we'll just check out how the gestures work as well. We have a new sound recorder app and a more customizable toolbar and redesigned Zorin appearance. And coming soon is a new Windows 10X like desktop layout. I think that might just be for their Ultimate Edition though, I think. This layout will be available as an option in Zorin OS 16 Ultimate. So come final release, I'll try and get my hands on the Ultimate Edition and we'll check all that out as well. And then we have Jelly Mode as well, which is kind of like a wobbly window effect for your application windows. And then there's some other improvements. I'll leave a link to this in the description below if you want to read that yourself, but with that being said, let's get this installed. Okay, so we've just booted into the ISO from a USB and we have a few options here. So we can either try or install Zorin OS, or for you NVIDIA users, you can try or install Zorin OS with modern NVIDIA drivers. I'm going to go ahead and just boot into try Zorin OS. Now before we get going, for those of you who like to skip the installation parts of these videos, there'll be a timestamp down below which will take you straight to the desktop. And here we are, so we can either try Zorin OS and go straight into a live environment, or we can go straight into it and install Zorin OS, which is what we're going to do. So first things first, we need to choose our keyboard layout, which for me is English UK, and we're just going to test it in this box below to make sure it's all working and then go to the next step. Right, so for updates and other software, it automatically has checked download updates while installing and install third-party software. But I'm also going to check this box here to do not to participate in the census. Next. So for the installation type, we're going to keep it super simple and do erase disk and install Zorin OS, and then choose the disk we're going to do it to on this page here. And we have been using the Drevo X1 SSD for the most recent videos, so we're going to go ahead and press install now. So I think that will be a two partition layout, but we're about to find out. There we go, so we've got two partitions, one for ESP and then a rest for our root partition with ext4 as the default file system. Continue. So for where are you, it's automatically selected London for me, which is all good, so we can go to the next step. User account time. So we're just going to call this one Zorin, type in our password, and I'm going to log in automatically, but we'll check out the login screen and lock screens and all of that anyway. So we're logging automatically and continue. So I think that's it, so I'll pause the video here and I'll come back once this has finished. Okay, so the installation has complete and it took just under 5 minutes on my machine. With that being said, let's reboot and check out our freshly installed Zorin OS 16. Okay, and here we are, and already it's looking like a very nice and pretty desktop, and quite clean actually. It doesn't appear to be a whole lot of clutter going on. So first things first, we do have the new welcome screen, which we'll quickly run through, and then we'll start playing around with things. So take the tour to learn your way around and discover essential features. So first up, open the menu to launch apps. We'll go through all of the menu and applications in just a moment. choose your desktop look with Zorin Appearance. So Zorin has sort of pre-configured desktop layouts that you can choose, and by default we have four here, and I do believe in the Ultimate Edition I have a few additional ones, but we'll check out the four that we have here in just a moment as well. Next, connect your online accounts. So I'm not going to worry about the online accounts for now, so we'll skip that part. And then we can link our phone with Zorin Connect, which I do believe uses sort of KDE Connect. Let's give that a go now. I've got some phones scattered around this room that should have KDE Connect running, so we'll give that a go now. So let's launch Zorin Connect. So start, connect your computer with your mobile device. Next. So it should find a few things. We'll see how we go. And there we go. So it's found two devices. We have a Galaxy S9 and a Plasma Mobile. So let's go ahead and just quickly sync up our Galaxy S9. So the device is unpaired. You may configure this device before pairing. So let's pair this device now. Okay, so we are now connected with our Galaxy S9, and we've just got a few notifications through already about me missing my alarms this morning. But there we go. So it's a nice little GUI for all of the things that you would do sort of with KDE Connect, like syncing your clipboard, sending and receiving files, and all of that good stuff. Let's go to the next step. Use software to find and install apps, and we'll go through that as well with the new inclusion of the FlatHub repository. Office Suite for work. So we have only Office and we have LibreOffice, which is already installed, or we could also choose to install only Office straight from the welcome tour. We'll stick with LibreOffice for now. Okay, and I do believe that's everything. So the kernel that we are currently using is version 5.8.0-50, and the default windowing system you are going to be using is X11. So with that out of the way, let's start taking a look around this desktop. So like I said, it is a very nice and clean, clutter-free desktop. We just have the single panel, which is at the bottom, and this is in the default layout. So we have our clock, as well as our things like our power, and to jump straight into the settings. And then we have some pinned applications here, and then we have our application menu, which we'll go through in just a moment. So we can now right click on our taskbar and go straight into it with the taskbar settings. But you can also lock and get it straight into Zorin Appearance from here, as well as settings, files, and system monitor. Let's open up the taskbar settings and see what we can do here. Okay, so we can change the panel size, we can set it to intelligently hide, and we can also override panel theme opacity. We can change the position, behavior, and action. So what we're going to do now is jump straight into the application menu, have a look at how that's been set up, and then we'll see what default applications we have installed out of the box. So we have our categories to the left with a search bar at the bottom, and then some quick little buttons for power off, restart, lock, and let's check out our lock screen now, so it should be nice and transparent, blurred for our desktop wallpaper. And there we go, so it's looking very nice with the default dynamic wallpaper, which we currently have set. So let's log back in and see what applications we do have installed out of the box. Okay, so let's start off in accessories and see what we've got. So we have clocks, we have files, and as this is basically the GNOME desktop environment, the files application will be Nautilus. Then we have maps, and we have text editor, which will be Gedit, to-do, and weather. Now in games, we have some pretty common sort of GNOME games that you're probably quite used to seeing in distributions like Mines, Sudoku, Mahjong, etc. We will install Steam and test out a round or two of CSGO and make sure that's all working without issues as well. Now in graphics, we have GIMP installed out of the box, very nice. We have our image viewer, LibreOffice Draw, and Photos. For internet, we just have the two packages here. So Firefox is your default web browser, and then it has Remina for remote desktops. Now in Office, we already know that we have the full LibreOffice suite, and then we have Evolution as our desktop email client, and Evolution is probably my favorite desktop email client to use when I'm using a GNOME sort of desktop. But before we sort of jump straight into the other applications, let's quickly open up LibreOffice Writer and make sure that's all set up properly with autocorrect working in our language and all of that good stuff. Okay, so it's using this view by default, so let's quickly jump straight into it, type a few things, and there we go, so we can see that autocorrect is working out of the box. Let's close that off and keep moving through the rest of these applications. So that's pretty much everything in Office, I do believe. And let's go down one into sound and video. Okay, so we've got a few things here. So we have Braziero, we have Cheese for webcams, we have PitV, which is I think like a video editor. I've never actually used it though. We then have Rhythmbox for our music library, sound recorder, and videos. And we'll do a little media test towards the end of this video as well. So in system tools now, we have GNOME Discs, software, which we'll go into in just a moment, settings, that's going to be like the GNOME control center, startup applications, we have the tour that we just went through, and then we have Zorin Appearance and Zorin Connect. We will spend a little bit of time in Zorin Appearance once we've checked out these applications. So in utilities now, we have Archive Manager, we have Backups, which I'm going to imagine is DejaDup. It is indeed. Let's close that off. And I actually use DejaDup quite a lot on my own computers as well. It's very handy. You can sort of back up over network storage and all of that good stuff as well. What else have we got? So we have Document Scanner, Document Viewer, and that's pretty much it. Okay, I think what I'm going to do before we make any changes to our system is do a quick reboot, check how much RAM we're using on a fresh boot, and then we'll start playing around with things. Okay, so before I rebooted, I also installed HTOP so we can see how much RAM we're using on a fresh boot. And as you can see there, it's not the lightest ever, but it doesn't claim to be, sitting at just under a gig at about 890, 900 MB. And we can see just below that, we do indeed have a swap file of 2GB. So I think what we should start off with is actually going through Zorin Appearance and also checking out the different desktop layouts that we can use from there as well. Now I don't know what the left super key is bound to by default, so let's check that out. So it's not the application launcher that we have on the bottom left, it's actually the overview for GNOME, and of course here's where you can get to your workspaces as well. And I think that's exactly what this button here does as well. It is indeed. So while we're in here, we're going to jump straight into it and type in Zorin Appearance and then start playing around with things. So before we get straight into the desktop layouts, and like I said, there is more to choose from in the Ultimate Edition, we'll go through some of the other sort of sections in this Zorin Appearance, and then we'll check out these different desktop layouts. So starting in fonts, the fonts we are using for our interface is Inter Regular, the document text is Sans Regular, the Mono Space text is JetBrains Mono Regular, and the legacy Windows titles are going to be using Inter Bold. So for desktops, we can choose how we want to do our desktop icons. I'm not someone that actually tends to use desktop icons much, if ever. I like a nice clean desktop, so I'm actually going to disable that, but it's nice to have that option straight there from the Zorin Appearance. So interface, so we've got a few things we can do here. So by default, your title bar buttons are going to be at the top right, but if you prefer them on your left, like a sort of Mac OS user might, you can also just click that little button there to move them straight to the left of the application window. I'll be leaving mine on the right. We can then disable animations entirely. And then we have the jelly mode button, which we saw in the release notes. Let's enable that. And now let's have a little look at how that all looks. There we go. So it's pretty much like wobbly windows, a sort of jelly-like sort of effect as it's sort of moving them around. And I think we'll leave that enabled as we sort of go through the rest of this desktop. Oh, cool. So like I mentioned, I didn't know what the left super key was actually bound to. We can actually choose its function straight from within the Zorin Appearance. So by default, it's the activities overview. I think I'm gonna have it as the Zorin menu though. So we'll do that, and now we press super, and it will open up the application launcher in the bottom left as opposed to the activities overview. So we have the activities overview hot corner. So does it have it disabled out of the box? Nice, they know who they're working with there. So I'm not a huge fan of hot corners, and I know that a lot of people do like it, but I've always found it a bit annoying because I'll accidentally trigger it. So I actually quite like that it's disabled out of the box. And then we can get straight into the taskbar settings in here as well. Okay, so that's interface. Now in theming, we can change the sort of way the desktop's going to look. So we're currently in like the light theme, or we can do a scheduled. Let's do that now. So you can see that we can change the schedule from manual or sunset to sunrise. And then we have the dark theme. So let's have a look at the dark theme. I quite like that. So that's the dark theme, and your sort of panel at the bottom has still got some nice transparency. And let's see what our file manager looks like with the dark theme enabled. There we go. So I quite like that, but I think we'll leave it on the light theme just while we're having a look through things. So that's pretty much everything there. And we can also change the accent colors. And then we have other. So under applications, we can change the theming, the icons, as well as the shell. So you can probably get away of not having to use GNOME tweaks too much as well with here, but we will install GNOME tweaks in just a moment because I want to see what they're sort of using to sort of change these desktop layouts. And that brings us straight on to the desktop layouts. So just before we get straight into it, I've gone ahead and installed GNOME tweaks so we can see what tweaks we do have installed out of the box. And then a lot of these will sort of enable and disable as you change the desktop layouts. So we have the applications menu, auto move windows, horizontal workspaces, launch new instance, native window placement, places status indicator, removable drive menu, remove drop down arrows, we have the screenshot window sizer, user themes, window list, workspace indicator, X11 gestures, and like I said, I have already got this installed now on the laptop, so we'll test out the gestures as well towards the end. Zorin app indicators, Zorin connect, Zorin desktop icons, Zorin magic lamp effects. That should mean that when we minimize our applications, like you've just seen, it's got the sort of magic lamp or genie effect, and it will shrink down into its applications icon. And then clicking it again, it should do the same, but in reverse. And there we go. So have we got anything else? We do. So we have a Zorin menu, the Zorin printers, Zorin taskbar, Zorin window move effect, and we have the window navigator. So quite a lot going on there. So now let's jump straight into it and check out these different desktop layouts. So with the default look here, with the Zorin panel at the bottom, we have the sort of icons only task list. So it'll have the actual icon itself, and then you'll minimize into that. And now we're going to test out the one just next to it. And there we go. So I think it's shrunk things down a little bit. And now our application windows here, I've got the full name of the title bar in that in the panel. And let's just see if our application launches any different, or it's pretty much the same. Okay, let's now test out this one right here. So that's now centralized. Our application's right in the middle of the panel. I quite like that. And it's also changed the look of these buttons here. So if we go to show applications, instead of the application launcher, now it's got the sort of whole dashboard that you should be used to when you're using the GNOME desktop. And I wonder if we can still move things around into their own little folders and stuff. We can indeed. And then we have the overview button right next to it. And then we have all of our sort of system tray sort of area in the same position. I quite like that. I like sort of having your icons in the middle. I think it looks quite nice. And then last but not least, this looks to be a bit more of a traditional GNOME sort of layout, but we'll have a look. And there we go. So it is pretty traditional there of the GNOME layout. So now we've got the panel at the top, and then our sort of our dash there for all of our favorites will be present when you go into the activities overview. And again, you have your workspaces to the right. And we also have this button now at the very left. And actually, yeah, I think that looks quite nice as well. I do really like the sort of theming of this desktop so far. So I think what I'm going to do is leave it in the default layout, the first one that we was on when we first installed, and then we'll start moving through the rest of this distribution. So I think what we'll do now is move into GNOME software and see how it's all working with the FlatHub repository enabled out of the box. We'll test out installing a few applications, native and Flatpaks. And as you can see there, we do of course have the Focal repos now, and this should all be supported until 2025. Okay, so here we are in GNOME software. So what we're gonna do is use this to install a few different applications. And we're also going to use it to install a Flatpak version of Kden Live. Let's go ahead and grab Kden Live first of all. And it should have the FlatHub repo enabled out of the box. So we have two entries. So if we click the first one, as you can see there in source now, it does have FlatHub. And we can also go to the sort of Zorin OS packages there. Or we can go back one, and then we'll have another option here, which will have a few more sources in the top right. So as you can see, we have the snaps, and we have the Zorin OS one there as well. And we can also get the FlatHub version from here too. So what I'm going to do is install Kden Live. Let's go ahead and grab that now. And I'm also going to install the native application for Steam so we can test out a round or two on CSGO. Okay, so all of our applications have been installed. Now we're just going to quickly search for Kden Live in our application launcher to see if it will appear there, although we might need to do a reboot for the first time that we use it. Let's give it a go. It's not. So what we'll do is we'll quickly reboot, make sure that Kden Live is installed as it should with the FlatHub repository, and then we'll keep moving. Okay, so we've just booted back up, and now let's go into our application launcher and see if we can search for and launch Kden Live from the FlatHub repository. And there it is. And there it is launching as well. So there we go. So we do have the FlatHub enabled out of the box in GNOME software to make it easy to install any application pretty much that you could want. So you have the native applications, snap applications, as well as the Flatpak applications, all from within GNOME software, making it very easy to install software, especially for a new user. So before we check out anything else, I wanted to go back to the Zorin taskbar and just quickly show you how the panel looks when you have enabled the panel IntelliHide, because I actually quite like what it does here. So we're going to just press that to enable it. And then as you can see, it sort of moved some space around, lifted our panel up from sort of the very edge of the bottom of the screen, and giving us some rounded corners, a little bit like what you'd expect from Deepin. And I actually think that looks very nice. And of course, anytime you get close to it or full screen an application, it's going to shrink below your display in a very nice and smooth animation. I'm going to leave it on always show for now, but I just thought that was a cool little thing that I wanted to show you guys. And of course, you can go through the position, behavior, action, and all of that good stuff. Now, with a right click onto your desktop, we can get straight into it with the change background. And then we can see all of the new wallpapers, as well as the default selection of the dynamic wallpapers, which are going to be changing throughout the time of day. So very nice. And while we're in here, we're also going to jump straight into display, because we now have the option for fractional scaling. So as you can see there, I've already enabled it, and that gives us the option for 100, 125, 150, etc. So very nice that that's all ready to go out of the box straight from the display settings in GNOME's Control Center. Okay, so another new feature that's made its way into Zorin OS 16 is the ability to now star files and documents straight from within Nautilus, which should make it easier to go back and find sort of files that you're currently working on as long as you've starred them, kind of like favorites. So if we go and open up Nautilus right now, we've got a screenshot here, so we can just do a simple right click, and then as you can see there, we have the ability to star. So we're going to star this now. It'll take a second and refresh the thumbnail, and now it should appear in starred along with any other file that we have starred, making it easy to go back to our favorite files and not lose them and sort of spend time hunting through different sort of directories until we find what we're looking for. What we're going to do now is jump over to the laptop and test out how these new gestures are working. So the new touchpad gestures uses four fingers to swipe up and down, and it will have one-to-one motion tracking, and it should pretty much move with the motion of your fingers. And as you can see here, it pretty much does, and it does feel very nice and fluid. The only issue that I had with the touchpad gestures so far was the new three-finger pinch to get into the overviews. I seem to struggle a little bit with that on my touchpad, but that might just be me, and your mileage might vary. So while we're still here on the laptop, I'll also use this as an opportunity to show you the sound recorder. So this new sound recorder is very simple, clean, and easy to use. You pretty much just press record and you are good to go. Once you finish recording, the recording will pop up here and you could either bin it, play it back, or then you can also export it. And the default file system it will use to export is a .flac file. So what we're gonna do now is just a very quick and simple media playback test to make sure it's all working out of the box. Now I have muted my volume, so I don't hear my voice playing back at me. I've also plugged in an external SSD, which is formatted in the XFAT file system, which is mounted without any issues at all. Now we're gonna test it out with an MP4 and an MP3. Bearing in mind, the programs that we've got to sort of manage these are Rhythmbox and Videos. So we're gonna start off with a simple double click kind of test to see what it's opening as the default application for an MP4. So it should be Videos, and there we go. Our media playback should be nice and smooth without any issues whatsoever. We're now gonna do the same thing for an MP3 and see what that opens it up as default. So we're gonna double click, and it's opened it up in Videos. So I think what we'll do instead is just either right click and go to open with other application. And there we have Rhythmbox in the recommended application. So we'll double click that, and it should now open it up in Rhythmbox, and it's playing absolutely fine. Perfect. What I wanna do now is have a little quick test of CSGO to make sure it's all working, we're not getting any weird sort of frame rate issues. And then we'll sort of start to wrap things up with some final thoughts with our first look of Zorin OS 16 ahead of its final release. So I've just jumped into a random online game of CSGO, and we're just gonna run around for sort of a few seconds and make sure frame rates are looking as what I'd expect them on this hardware, and that we're getting no weird sort of jitters or freezes, and everything is looking pretty much how I'd expect it. So we're hovering around the sort of 200 FPS mask, which is pretty much where I would be on this hardware regardless of which operating system I was using. So yeah, it's all looking pretty good. I think I'm gonna wrap it up there. So we're gonna jump back into the desktop, check a few more things out, and then we'll finish it up. So what we're gonna do now is change the theme to the dark theme, and we're gonna sort of see out the rest of this video having a little run through the desktop and seeing how the applications look with the dark theme enabled. Let's go straight back into it with theme, and we'll also change some of the different accent colors and see how it all looks. So we're gonna go straight into it with the dark background, and let's go for this accent color right there. Okay, let's open up a few things and see how it all looks. Now I do believe with the vertical workspaces that we are going to be using, the default shortcut for moving to the next workspace is gonna be Control Alt, and then your sort of directional keys for up and down. Okay, cool. Let's open a few applications and see how it all looks with this dark theme enabled. So we've already seen our Nautilus theme there, but there we can see it with the different accent colors with the green there. I'm not sure if I like the green with the black. It probably look a bit nicer with the white. Now let's open up something like Firefox, and let's also open up LibreOffice Writer and see what that looks like with the dark theme enabled as well. And of course you have the different sort of start page for your web browser, which is the Zorin start page with the Google search. And there we go. So let's see if we've got drag and drop all working as it should. We got a bit of a weird animation that happened there with LibreOffice. Let's try that again. Yeah, obviously this is very much a beta, so you are gonna notice weird little things like that. But there we go. So it's all working very nicely with the dark theme as well. So I think that's about where I'm gonna wrap it up. That's been my first look. As it's a beta, we're not really going to be reviewing things too much, but come final release, I'll try and also get hold of the Ultimate Edition and we'll give the whole thing a nice review. But so far, for a first look, I really like it, but then I've already quite liked Zorin anyway, and I think it's one of those distributions that does a quite a good job at welcoming new users regardless of what operating system they're coming over from. I'll leave a link to the release notes in the description below, which is where you can also download the ISO and give it a go yourself. Thank you for watching. If you've enjoyed this video, please subscribe, and if you've really enjoyed it, you can support me on Patreon. Join the Discord, there's a link in the description below. I'll see you on the next one. Bye bye.